Hello. So you know who I am. For about 15 years, I've been the executive director of a community health center north of here. I have served on 5 boards of directors as a volunteer. I do know something about the governance side, but I have to say, in my years on as boards, I've never seen the level of accountability or the amount of sophistication required to be a board member as you do these days. So my hat's off to all of the volunteers today. It's a very different time to be a board member, very challenging, so I thank you for that. 2 years ago in January, so just a couple of months from now, we held the first conversation. We didn't know it was called Rideau-Te Health Link at that time. We pulled together about 20 physicians, half a dozen nurse practitioners, some community health centers, and Dr. Jonathan Kerr, the primary care lead for the Southeast Lynn, pulled us to a meeting, and we all talked about this new idea, Health Links. And we went around the table, asked a lot of questions, and at the end of the, I guess it was about an hour and a half, we said, as a collective group, let's go ahead. And three or four of us put up our hand. My co-chair, Dr. Peter Knuff, was one of the very first. He's a, I'd say, belongs to a foe up in the Perth area. So he has been, he and I have been co-chairing this initiative since that time. I have to tell you, the Rideau-Te Health Link is, there was 5 that jumped out of the gate in the Southeast early, and then Rideau-Te Health Link and Salmon River down near Napanee were came along a little bit later. And I have to thank my 5 colleagues who went ahead of us because they shared all of their mistakes and all their successes with us. And any success we have, we've earned a lot of that from listening to Sherry Hudson-Fournier and my colleagues across the Southeast who really, really helped us, shared business plans, did everything. So we started with a group of physicians and nurse practitioners and hit the ground running, and about 3 or 4 months after that initial meeting, we had a large community meeting, mostly made up of staff and executive director types. There was a few board members there. Richard Schooley was one of them. And there were, and I don't even think I had anybody from our organization there, from our board. So we moved ahead, developed the business plan, and I realized after talking to a lot of my colleagues and getting, because HealthLinks is a little hard to get your head around, what exactly is it? And it became apparent to our group that there's a lot of potential here. There's a lot of potential for changing the system and creating something that we all want. And so I found myself quite excited, and the group, we pulled together quite a diverse group of lead table, and we started developing the business plan. And I started getting a little nervous as an executive director that I was going out on a fairly big limb and going out a lot further. And this potential to change was going to impact the organization I worked for. And I realized I hadn't brought my board along as far. And it's not a good place to be. In the wrong place where your board is. It's a career limiting. And so we had many conversations at our board, including the lead group wanted to know if Rideau Community Health Services would, because one of them have to be the host just to flow the money through. You aren't the boss, you don't run the health link, but would Rideau Community Health Services, so that I knew the board had to consider that. So we had lots of conversation at the board. We had board retreats about what a health link is and its potential. And they agreed that I could go ahead and sign on and move it as a, we would become the host or the coordinating body for the health link. So because our board was so engaged and Richard was at that initial meeting, and I ran into him a couple of times, and I remember his CAO, Linda Bisnett, saying, "You got to do something with Richard Schooley and HealthLinks. Please, Peter, get him doing something on that. That's all I'm hearing about." So we were able to channel some of that energy. We had a community connections committee on our board, which is a way to engage the board. And our friends at the Perth Smith Falls Hospital had this community liaison committee. those two groups got together and started talking, not necessarily about health links, but about opportunities to work more closely together. We were very aligned. I think the level of maturity within our organizations and in the board members, it was a very positive go around right from the start. It didn't hurt that Linda Bisnett and I went to grade school together in Toledo, but we went way back. Relationships do matter. That led to our boards talking together and saying and certainly the lead team we recognize that if I'm feeling a little nervous about maybe talking about shifting resources voluntarily between ourselves and around the patient or around the client we're serving, then maybe my other CAOs and their boards are feeling a little nervous as well, and maybe we should pull them together. And that's how we ended up with where we are. And we held our first, we call it a board-to-board meeting. And I'm turning it now over to my colleague, my past board chair, and he's currently on my board, who's going to just walk you through about what those boards did when they first came together and where we are today. And that'll be followed up by Richard with some of his musings. So Graham Bonham Carter will come up. We'll stay up here after Graham's and Richard are done, and we'll answer any questions you have.
Thanks, Peter. Many of you will have been at the meeting November of last year, which was a bigger meeting run by the Collaborative Governance Committee of the LIN. We'll remember that we had various talks about health links and were very inspired. And then they broke us down into tables. And I remember our table was table 7, and we had many of the participants, participating organizations that fell into the geography of the Rideau Tay Health Link. And it seemed clear to several of us that it was very important to, as boards, to understand what the other organizations within our Health Link did, because many of us had no idea about what some of the others did, and to get to know other board members personally. So Richard Schooley and myself decided to organize board-to-board meetings for the Rideau Tay Health Link. And I was absolutely amazed that we actually had 14 boards involved. And we had about 40, in fact, over 40 people at the two meetings we've had. We had one in January and one in June. And they were both, let me put on the next slide. We've actually had two meetings to date. thank you, Peter. we did have EDs that came to this these meetings, and the first two meetings were facilitated by Christine Perringer. Christine had been on the was one of the people writing the business plan, so she was very thoroughly familiar with the mechanics of what was involved in the Health Link. And one of the things, incidentally, we did at the last meeting in June was to appoint a Health Link champion for each board so that they would be the liaison with their parent board, would come to meetings every time. But our meetings have not been restricted just to the champions. We've encouraged as many people from any of the boards to come as possible. And I think that's been a good idea. Now, at the first meeting, we had a number of breakout sessions to try and identify what sort of roles the boards should be taking in dealing with health links and the governance of health links. And many of the topics that I will be showing you in a second, we've already heard something about and seen in on the agenda. They're fairly obvious ones, but these were very important to kind of work through from the point of view of the membership of these boards. So I'm going to go through these nine roles that were identified, and we identified them at the first meeting, and then at the second meeting, we reviewed what people had actually done and what their plans were. Incidentally, I'm talking to an audience here that many of you were at both of those board meetings, and so I kind of apologize that for regurgitating this same stuff, but maybe it's a refresher. So the first item was to embrace the idea that HealthLink success would require us all to change. We've got to all start thinking about the system and not our own little silo. And four boards had actively explored this before the second meeting, either in the form of special board meetings or retreats. And so there was a general level of understanding about what this involved that was definitely improved at the second meeting. The second item was to ensure that our organization's mission, vision, and key strategies align with the HealthLink shared purpose and goals. In the case of the Rideau Community Health Services, we actually added a new strategic direction to our strategic plan. The hospital did something very similar, and I believe several of the other boards have now taken the same steps. But this is obviously very important so that our EDs don't feel too much out on a limb, as Peter mentioned. Then the HealthLink goals use those goals to inform help the selection. If you're in the position of hiring a new ED or CEO, we fortunately weren't in that situation. But it's obviously vital in the selection process to include that as part of the criteria. And three boards have been very active on this. And again, I know that the hospital, this definitely played an important role in their hiring. The fourth one was work with the ED to set metrics. And we're just really only getting our health link going, so we haven't got very far with that. But I think several of the boards mentioned that they had been thinking about this aspect at the last meeting. We need to ensure that our organization is responsive to community needs. This is certainly something that in our case, our community engagement committee, they're actively thinking about this problem. And a number of the activities that we're doing in terms of community engagement involve thinking about how that relates to health links. Number six is include health link advocacy in our communication with community funders and other stakeholders. I think this is extremely important as well. We're going through the process of a new strategic, of a new communication plan, of which this will be a component. And I think we would all agree that this is obviously something that's important. Number seven was to review all aspects of our governance board recruitment, orientation, learning, evaluation, etc., in relation to achieving health link goals. And this has certainly been part of our last recruitment process. I think that we could definitely, in our case, include something about orientation. I think for new board members, most boards have a turnover all the time, and having some orientation that included information about health links would be very valuable. Number eight was to continue to explore how best to support the Rio Tinto Health Link success. Well, I don't think I need elaborate on that, but I think as boards we need to be thinking about how we can promote and improve health links all the time and keep up to date with what's going on. And of course, nine is to take action in collaboration with other boards of directors within RTHL. And I think the biggest benefit of our board-to-board meetings is that it's enabled us to get to know other board members and develop some personal relationships. And I think this will help in developing collaborations. So these nine board roles were then identified at the first meeting and were revisited at the second, and I'm sure we'll continue to do that. We're also having interim reports at least every 3 months between our 6 monthly board meetings to keep that whole community of board members up to date with what's going on, and the health champions will be the people to provide that bridge to their own boards. And we believe that these meetings are important to the success of the Rio Tinto Health Link because, firstly, they allow boards to get to know each other. Secondly, they help boards to understand the other organizations and what they do. And they provide a forum for discussion of collaborative governance. Thank you.
Thank you, Peter, and thank you, Graham. When we were discussing getting ready for this evening's meeting, I decided to take as my challenge to describe what I felt were the enablers to collaborative governance. And I think where we started, all of us have experienced or have heard anecdotally about the challenges that some of the folks in our community have negotiating our health system. And I see that as and I think we all see that as a challenge. In fact, in some cases, it's been embarrassing, and in the odd case, troubling, and too frequently, our system causes as much anxiety navigating the system as it does, as the anxiety is created from the illness or the disease. When we looked at it, and I'm saying we, I'm not talking about me and Peter and Graham, when our system looked at it, healthcare in silos, communication challenges, a client understanding of the system, what to expect, when to expect, etc., seem to be the most easily identified causes. Too often, and for too long, in developing, our healthcare funders identified that uncoordinated care was not only producing less than optimum outcomes for our clients, but it was also expensive, and we were near exhausting our funding resources. New eyes looked at the situation, new eyes that, in my observation, looked at the situation, putting the client at the center of the challenge, and in so doing, identified a potential for better, more satisfying care with a potential for a system saving. HealthLinks was the policy response. It was granted an expectation, a framework. It was granted the opportunity to access funds for the planning and implementation. This was offered, and the outcome organizations were expected to achieve left them with a mandate to respond to the healthcare needs of the identified population. And so, what enabled governance to come together? Well, it was a universally accepted service delivery challenge, and that met up with a framework. It met up with funding, and it met up with a mandate, and governance responded. My personal feeling is that as governors, and I know we're not all governors in this meeting tonight, but as governors, we're ready to respond. I think that our organizations are ready to respond. So if we continue putting the patient at the center of our service delivery, our organization's desires to contribute to client wholeness and compassionate care, when we did all of those things, bringing 14 organizations together to address that and support HealthLinks was not a huge leap to make. There's absolutely no doubt in my mind that the initiative will substantially contribute to improving patient experience and their health. Will it save money? That's the question yet to be answered. What enabled collaboration, again, repeating it, was an integration, was the provision for satisfying integrated care, a policy framework, implementation, funding, and a mandate. I'm equally satisfied that for all of our healthcare communities, there is not one solution to respond to all the healthcare delivery system challenges in the Lynn or indeed in Ontario. I'm also satisfied that our government understands that. I'm equally satisfied that as healthcare governors, there is a desire, a need, a wish to be doing better with our financial resources. So I guess I'm playing devil's advocate. We've identified HealthLinks as being a vehicle, a tool. We've seen it responding to the 3 to 5% of our healthcare community that are our most frequent users. Someone used the term frequent flyers. And we've responded to that so successfully. So my personal prejudice is if we can use the same sort of a framework to address the wholeness of our primary care services and integrate that to our secondary care and tertiary care services, that we will indeed get ourselves moving down a path to rationalizing resources with outcomes. The other part of this process that I have primary in my mind is the necessity when we're looking at organizing or reorganizing our healthcare services that we keep in mind the part that healthcare plays in the economic viability or economic development potentials for our communities. And it's only with wholeness of service that as communities we're going to remain viable and attract and keep people living in our communities. We all know from looking at our demographics, when we look at the information that Lynn is providing to us, that we are in a really challenging position. We have, and I'm speaking my own community, we have a stagnant population. We have a very rapidly aging population. We have as a community to be addressing that, responding to that. And the necessity is that we maintain a very healthy, vibrant, strong healthcare system. And I think we can do it. And I think we can ensure our future viability. But we have to work together and we have to get a vehicle that allows us to accomplish this. And so I'll leave my comments at that point. And thank you very much.